Essentially, who I want to talk to at the moment would be people that are involved in development, because this question has been asked from me a lot of times every time I go to a party or every time I go to a specific game convention like this, is that there are several questions that come to mind, like, Chase, what are publishers looking for? Like, how do I get my game published? Like, we're doing this game, and how do we get it rolled out into a massive scale, say, for example? And it's always a very difficult question for me to answer as well, because there is a certain, you know, list of things that you can do as a developer. There is no magic formula in terms of, like, what game you have in your portfolio or in your back catalog that would allow you to get published. Obviously, there's a lot of factors involved, and I'm somewhat here to scratch the surface of what it is, because, like, if we are to go in-depth on this one, it's gonna take a long time, though. Just a quick introduction about myself. I haven't been in the gaming industry for a very long time. I've been here 5 years, but prior to that, I was involved in finance and tech before finally joining the industry. Previously, I held a position as business development manager for a gaming company in Chengdu called Tap for Fun. So we developed games and we also published them at the same time. And I normally work with marketers. I normally work with developers, both internal and external, in terms of reviewing their games and checking and seeing if there's anything I can help them with as far as making it into a commercial proposition. And currently, I'm the director of product and marketing for RT Games. All right, so just a quick introduction of RT Games. We are, RT Games is a leading publisher of free-to-play games for both browser and mobile. And most recently, we just released our game called Heroes Evolved, which is a client MOBA game. As far as platform is concerned, right now we do have about 50 million, give or take, registered users in our platform. And we've published hits like Wartoon, League of Angels, and Dragon Files on browser. And currently, we're also publishing mobile games, such as Politicats, Shards of Magic, and Grave Diggers, as well as Heroes Evolved on mobile as well. So these are the current developments happening in the company, and as a publisher, we're always open to bringing in newer games and try to publish them in certain markets. So I guess the first question is, like, how do I find a publisher? And I guess, like, my answer to that is, like, it's something that as business development and every development team has, it's something that he needs to look for, right? And, you know, this is a perfect place to look for one. You go to other conventions, it's the same thing. There's a whole host of business development meetings that you can do to ensure that you can find yourself a publisher that you can make a pitch to, right? And I guess the biggest thing that we always think about when we talk about publisher and developer is that developers are here to make great games. And essentially, publishers are here to make money. But that's not all there is to it, essentially. Because we're looking at partnership here, and the developer's success is actually the publisher's success, in the same way that a successful publisher would pretty much have a better way of having better relations with their publisher or with their developers. So when we are looking for the developers, we're not only looking on a game perspective as a game publishing. At some point, as a publisher, we're also looking into incubating or funding several developers that we think is aligned with the vision and the direction of the company. And also eventually at some point, if it's something that's really aligned with our vision, we can acquire a specific developer. But on your end as a developer, also think about what you want to happen with your group, with your team, and your company. Do you want to publish it on a game basis, or eventually do you want to scale up a little bit further and work with a publisher in general? Because the publishing landscape with the availability of, say, for example, Google Play and the App Store allows developers to become publishers too, right? It's just a matter of scaling, because normally investments, money in general, goes into publishers, and publishers are able to scale it up because they do have the marketing budget, they do have distribution platforms, they do have the connection, and they do have the knowledge as well on the marketing side of things. And as what I always say to developers, sometimes I go and say, Chase, how do I market my game, right? How do I make it successful? And you know, these are things that as a developer, if you think about it, it's taking away precious time away from you making the game itself, instead of being distracted and doing all the business developments or all the other things that you need to do for specific games in your portfolio. So moving on. So what do publishers look for? So that's a question that has been asked me last night, and so I decided to put it up here. Essentially, publishers look for two things, right? On the game perspective, and also on the developer perspective, right? A long time ago, publishers are just mostly focused on just the game itself. But now, publishers are slowly realizing that sometimes their product pipeline becomes very, very slow depending on the availability of games to publish. And because of that, they're also realizing that at some point we have to have a foothold somewhere in a development team or several development teams that we invest on so that we could go ahead and have specific flagship games somewhere within a year pipeline while still continuously publishing smaller games in the process so that the year-on-year revenue is continuous. So if we're looking for a game, I would sum it up into three. We're looking for novelty. How unique the game is. Is it something that we haven't seen in the market before? We're also finding it really important to make sure the game has a fitting game type with the types of products that we're publishing, because I don't want to publish a game which I have no idea how to make successful. Each publisher have their own sort of like niche or things that they're really good at publishing. And so for our two games, for example, if it's an MMORPG game, or a strategy game, or even a clicker idle game, that's something that I'll not shy away from, because like, that's something that we have done successfully in the past. But let's say, for example, you talk about, say, a game that's focused primarily on females, maybe I'll probably say no to that, because it's something that's not right up my alley. And lastly would be strength, right? I have to see something within a game that's, you know, strong, whether it's like a monetization structure or the core loop of the game. There has to be something special about the game so that this piece of work that you work so hard can be turned into a commercial proposition. Because sometimes as a developer, and I think this has been mentioned a while ago, is that, you know, we have standards and we want to make our game as best as we can. And you know, the truth of the matter is, once you work with publishers, there will be a lot of trade-offs. There will be changes that will be asked of you in terms of like how the game should be directed to. And sometimes you feel like, okay, this doesn't seem like it matches the integrity of the kind of game I want to make. And that's pretty much something that always happens when I work with developers. And so I assure them that, you know, we have to meet somewhere in the middle, because while this is something artistic or something beautifully made, it has to at some point be turned into a commercial proposition as well, because you also have to flow it into the business. On the developer side of things as well, we're looking for agility. Especially on a freemium game or a free-to-play game where you're selling it as a service, it's really important that there is flow and movement within the developer side of things. What I'm saying is that and I'll discuss it later on as well, is that on the marketing side, for example, there are certain things that I would need to get changed or updated or replaced in a specific period of time because I, say, for example, wanted to get featured by Google Play. And they say, okay, if you want to get featured, these are the things that I wanted to see, or these are the things that we should actually put it in, right? And so having said that, I have to go back to the developer and say, hey, is it possible if we do this, if we do this content, if we add more things to the game so that we can go ahead and make it more viable for featuring in the app stores? Because getting featured is essentially free amount of users into the game. And also I'm looking for vision. At least I wanted to see something within the game that would make me say, all right, they do have something that is solid. They do have something that in a specific roadmap of like a year or 6 months or even 3 months, All right, they know where they're going. And lastly would be excellence. Excellence in what? Right, it could be anything. It could be excellence in backend tech. You might be like the best game design studio there is, right? But there has to be something that's good in a development studio. It could be because like, oh, we just leave and breathe strategy games, for example. We just love strategy games. Like that's why we always do every day and every night. Like there's nothing else we do. Right. That for me is something that's very, very attractive, and that would make me gravitate towards that specific developer. And obviously, it's the game itself. Like if it makes me feel excited to play the game, if the office feels excited to play the game, then that is something that we can work on. So my question is like, I guess it's something that I shouldn't answer because it's a question for developers, but what do you look for in a publisher? Right? And that is a question that you probably need to ask yourself and the people that you work with, because it's not only the publisher that chooses the developer. It's mutual, right? It's a relationship. So in as much as a publisher wants your game, for example, if you don't want to work with us as a publisher, that's something that I cannot do anything about, right? Until, of course, I can basically work with us, though. But the thing is, you have to ask yourself, like, as a developer, what do I want? And essentially, you have to choose, for me, I think, number one, you have to choose a publisher that's aligned with your goals, right? There are publishers that just wanted to take in whatever game that comes their way and see and find out whether that works or not, right? And it's sort of like, you know, like, collect, and then eventually find out exactly which one works and which one doesn't. And I noticed for a fact, because I'm not, even though I'm mostly involved in publishing, I do have a lot of friends who are developers. And a lot of times, like, they were saying, oh, I got burned by this company because they promised me this, but, you know, after, like, putting all my effort into the game, they just decided not to promote my game, for example, or just put it in their backend catalog without doing anything about it. Right, or at least not trying, right? When you're looking for a publisher, it doesn't necessarily have to be the biggest publisher. It can be a small publisher, as long as you know the publisher takes care of you and respect the game that you're making. Right? The reason I'm saying this is, say for example, in China where I'm from, the biggest publisher we have domestic-wise would be Tencent. You have NetEase, you have Kunlun, for example, and these publishers, They have a platform that is very, very accessible. And I'm telling you, like about 90% of people in China goes to Tencent and say, all right, I want to play this game, right? So visibility-wise, if you get published by Tencent, for example, in China, it's a good thing, right? But at the same time, you don't, unless of course it's a game that's extremely fantastic, extremely unique, and you know the publisher is very, very excited about, you probably will not get as much love as the other games that get published within their portfolio, right? So it really depends. It doesn't necessarily have to be a big, big publisher. It could be a very, very small publisher, as long as you know and you're confident that they know what they're doing. And the third one is, choose a publisher with the capacity to get you discovery. Because if you can do it yourself, why would you get yourself published? If your goal is to just basically get discovered, get a certain amount of users, and that's it, I'm happy, then you can do it yourself. But publishers can take you to greater heights if you work with them properly, and if they work with you properly. If they can direct you to a direction where it's good for the game, right? And I guess a few things that you might want to try to look for publishers is demographics. Meaning, as a publisher, where are they strong at? Like, as I mentioned, for example, with R2 Games, if it's a female-oriented game, I'm probably going to say yes to that, though, even though it's a very wonderful game. Like, there are times wherein I've seen a lot of really, really beautiful and nicely made games, but I just have to say no. Not because the game is not good, but because I don't have the capacity to honestly say to you, eye to eye, and say, all right, we're going to make this happen. Because I can't do it, right? And that's the kind of thing that I'd like to operate in, because I don't want that relationship to be one-sided. Second would be geo expertise, right? where are they good at? Are they good at doing Southeast Asian publishing? Are they good at doing Russian publishing? Are they good at doing Chinese publishing? Right? Because there are certain geos that requires a different kind of expertise, and you also have to take a look at that. Third one is gamer profile. That's older white, by the way. Gamer profile is important because as a developer, it is very, very important that you understand exactly who are you developing the product for, right? I think it's the same way with marketing, wherein in the past, we go and say spray and pray, right? So basically, spray it out to everybody and hope that at least one or two or three people get to pick up that game and say, all right, we can build from here, right? Now with the publisher being able to work with a lot of different developers, they have amassed tons and tons of data that would actually help them out in terms of how to move forward. And the fourth one is, do they have a platform? Do they have a platform internally to get you discovered? And do they have access to platforms externally to also help you get discovered, right? As I mentioned, you also have access to platforms in as much as developers do, as much as the publishers do, right? But it's just a matter of how do we build on it and make it bigger? So it's just, this is an example of R2 Games platform users. When I say platform users, this is from our browser games. So as far as demographics are concerned, we are looking at about 47 million registered users right now in R2 Games platform. And out of that, about 81% are male and 19% being female. And in terms of the age range, we're looking at about 18 to 44 years old as the predominant users within the platform. So the next question is, when you're working with publishers, do you want to work with only one publisher for a specific game, or do you want to work with multiple publishers? That is also a question that's always being asked of me. And my answer to that question is, it really depends on where you want to grow. So with R2 Games, for example, our publishing is mostly international publishing, with domestic publishing happening in the first quarter. Right? It's completely weird though, because as a Chinese company, we started off doing international publishing first before doing domestic publishing, because of the lack of maturity internally within domestic publishing in China. And it's really, really difficult to have this level of guts in terms of like being in competition with a company like Tencent, which is basically a building away from where I work, right? So when I get out of my office, the next building right next to me are people saying hello to me from Tencent. Okay. But don't worry, we're friends. Like people are friends, they're in that building, right? Because domestic publishing is very, very challenging in China. And this is something that took time for R2 Games to really try to further understand. Because we've been established back in 2009, but during those times we focused on international publishing, right? And so now, 2017 is more of like an exploration of what we're missing out internally. Because in terms of market size, as of last year, I believe, like late last year, I believe, China has overtaken US as far as the domestic market size is concerned. Right, so it's now China, US, Japan, and Korea, or Russia, perhaps. So in this case, even as a developer, you can actually look for publishers that can take care of you for the rest of the world. Look for a specific publisher that can take care of you in Southeast Asia. Because even though, say, for example, I'm from the Philippines, I have no idea how to publish in my own country. Right? It's something that I'm being honest about, because like, people would ask me, hey Chase, you're from Southeast Asia. How is the pulse of the market in Southeast Asia? And I'm gonna go smile at him or her and say, I have no idea, I'm sorry about that. Japan and Korea is the same thing. It's a very, very special market, and so you may have to look for another publisher that is an expert in that specific region. So let's say, for example, you are already successful in looking for a publisher. You got your game published. Of course, the money aspect, the negotiation, the deal terms, profit sharing, minimum guarantees have all been discussed, right? That's a different topic altogether. But let's say, for example, you've already agreed with, you know, what the publisher would pay you as far as money is concerned, what kind of relationship you're going to enter into. Will they be working on you on just the product level, or will they be working with you on the developer level? Will they be supporting your development costs at some point, right? Will they be supporting you in terms of coming up with another product after the initial product that you're working on, right? So these are things that you can discuss with the publisher. And the publishers normally have an outright answer for you already when they discuss deal terms, but deal terms typically varies depending on one developer to another. Obviously, like, your burn rate is very, very important for a publisher, for them to fully understand exactly how you operate. So when you're working with publishers, you have to make sure. So when you're working with publishers, you have to make sure that you know what you want and you know what you're getting. In other words, make sure that you cover your ass as far as like what you wanted the publishers to do for you. And the reason why I'm saying this is not because there's this level of distrust on a publisher level, but the reason why I'm saying this is at the end of the day, these are still businesses, right? And I'm working for one, right? And as a business, obviously, we're looking for partnerships, but at the same time, we're looking to turn in profit at some point, right? And the thing that I normally work with as far as the developers are concerned is that I want the developers to feel at the end of a deal, for example, that they got the best deal out of it. I want us to feel that there's a sense of fairness into the deal. There's a level of mutual trust and understanding that these are the things that the publishers will do for me, and these are the things that developers will do for the publishers, right? I don't want you to think that just because there's a publisher that's interested in you and they're trying to sort of like sway you off to the left side of the deal term, you don't necessarily have to say yes right away. Right? There are other opportunities out there where you can actually look for publishers that completely respect you as a developer and that completely respect your work as a developer as well, right? It's a time where both developers and publishers are equally empowered to basically switch the balance in terms of like what kind of relationships you would expect from each other. So I guess the first thing that we normally do once we start publishing the game is that apart from investing on the game heavily, apart from shouldering the marketing costs, is that first off, we'll look at five things here. There's even more on the list. I'm just gonna focus on five things. As a game, we localize the game. We work on the game on a branding PR perspective. We put in performance marketing on the table as well. So we spend marketing dollars for you guys. We also work on live operations for the game, as well as data intelligence, right? So on localization, yesterday somebody asked me, or I was talking to a publisher, I think, or a developer. I don't remember. But essentially, the conversation went like this in terms of localization. So if your game does well, we are going to localize it. And we're going to put it in more languages. And I sort of disagree with that in a way, because just because a game becomes successful in the US doesn't necessarily mean that it will become successful in Russia, for example. I've seen a lot of that, including with my own games, right? And just because you think the game will not be successful in China, it doesn't mean that you should stop trying, right? And so localization, for example, some publishers have them in-house, RT Games have them in-house. So when a developer gets published by RT Games, automatically it gets localized in 9 different languages or even more, right? Because that would also give you leverage on the marketing side to make it more attractive in not just a single market, but multiple markets as well, right? We also work on the game, on the branding and PR side of things. Performance marketing, and we're talking about user acquisition here, because that's, I think, where the biggest issue of scale is on the developer side of things. You have a wonderful game, you have a great game, but there are not a lot of users coming into the game. And if there are a lot of users coming into the game, they are mostly focused on a specific market. Say, for example, the Philippines, right? But how do we get out of it? How do we go from the Philippines to the US? Or how do we make it big in China, for example? Right? And that's something that publishers should be able to help you out with. And also live operations being the fourth one. And I think this is very, very important. And I'll talk about live operations in a bit as well. So going back to the question a while ago, so what should publishers do? I think there are three things that publishers should do for the developers. The first one is very, very vague and very, very general, but it is essentially to support developers to enable them to do their jobs. Publishers should be able to fill in the gaps in terms of where the developer is missing something so that we could continuously operate the business as a service. Second would be, we need to ensure substantial user flow into the game. Whether that's by discovery or by user acquisition, there has to be something wherein we're continuously flowing in users into the game. And lastly would be supporting developers' direction on what works and what doesn't work on a marketing perspective. Because in experience, being able to publish a lot of games sort of like gives you an idea already of what works and what doesn't in specific markets or regions. So just touching on the first point, which is localization, and how do developers work with publishers on localization, is that typically a publisher will take care of everything on the localization side. Meaning, they will do the culturalization aspect, they will do the translation aspect, they will come up with a language pack. The only thing the developer needs to do is to implement the language pack into the game, right? And there has to be a certain amount of bandwidth that's put into a developer side of things. So, for example, this is our game, one of our games called Politicats. It's a clicker game developed by a US Boston-based developer called AttackLab. We've worked with them in their very first game called Bigfoot Hunter, which we've published a few years ago. And most recently, I'm working with them on publishing Politicats. It wasn't much of an issue localizing Politicats because, number one, there's not a lot of word count. Right, it doesn't have a lot of texts, so to speak. But bigger projects with bigger content, it's a little bit more difficult to localize. I think the biggest issue in localization, and I don't think it's going to be a problem here in the Philippines, is that in China, for example, when we're building games, it's built without the concept that at some point in the future it might be localized. So let's say their user interface, the boxes, the tick boxes, they're all in Chinese, which is character based. So you have two characters for a very, very long German word. And that happened a lot of times for us, and it became very, very slow in terms of like releasing games. So some of the developers that we're working with right now in China, for example, have made it a habit to actually start the game in German, and then Chinese, and then English afterwards, just because it will be easier to adjust the UI if they develop in a language wherein it's easier for them to actually make localizations. And localization is something continuous. Every time there is a game update, every time you have to update your game for, say, for example, Google Play or Apple features, localization needs to be there. And so that's a continuous process that you work with a publisher as a developer. The second one will be branding and PR. And the reason I'm talking about this one is that a lot of people are asking, does it matter who my publisher is? Does it matter if I'm published by EA, for example? Or does it matter if I'm published by Kabam? Or by Rovio or Gree, for example, right? And the answer for that is yes and no, right? Now, some publishers have IPs that that they'd be able to publish successfully. So for example, Kabam, Marvel Contest of Champion, right? So we're looking here at the halo effect. We're in, oh, they have Marvel. So maybe if this other game is by Kabam as well, that helps. But that's not the only thing. I think that IT in general is very, very expensive at the moment, but that's something that a publisher can also provide and acquire and eventually trickle down into a specific developer they want to work with if they want the developer to develop something for them. So oftentimes that's where deal terms also matter, because sometimes there are developers who bring in their own IP into the publishing, and there are publishers who bring in their IP and ask developers to say, all right, we want to make something out of this Batman IP or this Aliens versus Predator IP. What can we do, right? The third one is where it's probably the most crucial, marketing, right? On the game side of things, it is really good that you have a wonderful product that works fairly well with a really good core loop on a free-to-play market, for example. But if nobody can discover that game, it's really going to be very difficult for you to recoup all your losses in terms of development cost. And that's the reason why you need users upon users upon users to play your game, right? Right now, game visibility and distribution is very, very challenging. The app stores right now has about 600,000 to 700,000 games or even more, right? And, you know, the competition is tough. Every week, thousands of games get added into the app stores, right? So once you actually put in your game on the app store, it's going to get drowned by other games, especially bigger developers or bigger publishers who can essentially get their titles across because they have, say, for example, relationships with Google. Back in December, for example, what did you see in the Apple App Store, for example? It's all Super Mario, right? All the banner heads on the App Store is all Super Mario, Super Mario, Super Mario, and Super Mario. And new games we love, the first game you see there is also Super Mario Brothers, right? And that's the powerful relationship. They're able to put their games there because it's mutually beneficial for both Apple and Nintendo to actually cross-promote. So which leads me to the next point, which is getting featured, especially for mobile games. Right? Getting featured is very, very difficult. Say, for example, give or take on a weekly basis, on best new games on Google or best new games on Apple, there's usually about 30 to 40 new games on a weekly basis, which usually comes out on Thursday. And so every once in a while you go and say, all right, I'm a developer and I wanted my game to be featured so badly. So you refresh your Apple Store on a Thursday and say, where am I here? Nope, I'm nowhere, right? And that doesn't help because discovery in the stores, number of downloads allows you to get rankings higher on the other aspects of the App Store, right? So you have top grossing games, top free games, right? If your game is not viral, say for example, like Flipping Bottle, though, right? That's a really, really good game because it's very, very viral, right? And that enabled them to scale the ranks in the stores, right? But if the game is not viral, how else will we get discovered, right? By marketing, by user acquisition. And then there's the whole chicken and the egg thing wherein the developer says, all right, the game isn't that viral and it's not gonna be featured on the App Store, so maybe we can buy users for you. And the publisher would say, sure, no problem. I'm gonna buy users for you. And then comes in marketing. And then you realize that, okay, the lifetime value of each customer in the game is $1. And you want to make it big in the US. The problem I have is, I don't think I can get you a user for $1 in the US. And that's where the whole problem happens. What do we do? Oh, maybe we can adjust the game. Maybe we can improve the core loop. Maybe we can strengthen the monetization. And then that's where the adjustment happens over and over again. And that's where agility comes in. As a developer, you should be able to understand and adjust how you can make your game monetized better. Because now you're now venturing in from a thing that you love to do the most, which is creating good games, and turning it into a business. And that's the most challenging part for me as well, because you know, when I consult with developers and say, all right, so what can we do to make it better? What can we do to increase our lifetime value, for example? that's where relationship, that's where developer and publisher needs to work together. Thermal will be distribution platform, right? That's also part of marketing, right? Typically, you have the most common distribution platforms, which is Amazon, the App Store, and Google Play, right? And sometimes, publishers would have their own distribution platforms as well, right? If your publisher has a distribution platform, then it's easier for them to promote you or cross-promote you within their own platform with the millions or hundreds of thousands of users. But if they don't have that, then they also have to rely equally on Google Play, on Apple, on Amazon, on the Samsung stores, or other smaller stores that's out there in the market. And I'm not counting just Google Play and Apple here. There are a lot of different stores, distribution platforms, say for example in China, because there's no Google, there are thousands, or I wouldn't say thousands, that's an exaggeration, but hundreds of distribution platforms in China alone for Android. So I guess I'm just gonna keep on this one because this is too technical and user acquisition. So App Store featuring, right? I guess I'm gonna touch on this one. I think the from Google Play also discussed a little bit about getting featured on Google Play Store. As a developer and publisher relationship progresses, when we start with releasing a game, the first thing that I make sure is that, is the game something that I can get featured on the App Store? As a publisher, it's beneficial for me because it would allow me to leverage on the stores to bring in thousands and hundreds of thousands of users. And that's already about $500,000 or $600,000 worth of marketing spend, right? And if you have that relationship, if you're able to actually get your games across Google and Apple for a feature, why not, right? And the thing with this one is that obviously there are minimum requirements that needs to be met, apart from the games being wonderfully made, perfectly done. Like there has to be a way for you to be able to adjust your game to fit into what Apple looks for and what Google looks for. All right. So say for example with these games that we've launched in the past until today, most recently we got featured in the App Store for Politicats. It ran for about one month in the App Store because they went on a vacation for Christmas, which is good for us, and they were not able to change the things in the App Store. So typically they go on a vacation from mid-December and go back on January. So normally you get a feature on a weekly basis, right? But because there's nobody there, like, okay, yeah, sure, no problem, just keep it there, right? It was on the Christmas collection, wherein they have this very, very special curation on their stores, right? And that enabled us to gather about 200,000 to 300,000 users just on that specific month alone for the game. So typically when we release games, we always look for, all right, we want to be best new games. Every time there's an update that needs to be done as far as putting more content into the game, we want to be best new update. If it's Valentine's Day and there's something happening on Google, we want to make sure that we put Valentine's Day content on the game, or in-app purchases that says Valentine's Day, or booster packs and packages in the game that says, you get a Valentine's Day card or something. Your heroes, I don't know, like you can put a Cupid hero or something if like it's an RPG game, for example, right? In the same way that like in Christmas, I've seen a lot of games with Santa Claus heroes or content or Christmas-based events in the game as well. So for minor features, for example, on Apple and Google, we're looking at about 10,000 to 90,000 users that we normally get. For medium features, that's where you get about 100,000 to 300,000. And major features is where you normally get up until a million downloads. And when I say major feature, we're looking at this banner row right here, where we usually like see five games or in total to get it on the banner row feature. But anyway, I am over time, so which means I'm probably gonna skip a few things, but you can ask me later. You can find me roaming around here. If you wanna talk to me about live operations and how does that affect you as a developer, which I think is one of the most integral part of the relationship, because that's continuous, like weekly events, you know, how do we make sure that as a developer we avoid fatigue and content burn for the players that we already have. We can talk about that somewhere else. But other than that, do you guys have any questions? No questions?
Yes.
All right, well, yeah.
Will you be publishing this on a slide share elsewhere? Because there's a lot of data here. It's very good.
I can publish it on a slide share. I'll let you know. I'll let you know later. I'll also give you my email address as well.
Thank you.
No problem.
Any more questions, guys?
All right. Thank you, guys. Have a good day.